Hello, investors. I'm your host, Jonathan Pruitt, and this is This Kingdom Tonight. Well, barley is up, wheat is down, and ergot poisoning has left rye futures in question, so I hope you like white bread. And a recently discovered dragon horde has plunged the nation of Cormyr into hyperinflation. Oof, we're gonna get medieval on that economy on this WebDM. Let's have Jim with the weather.
It's hot, but I hear we have an ice age coming up.
Okay, Jim, the PHB, we talked about how to spend money and you got gold and that's great and all. What do you think the economy, if there is one,
sure,
that the PHB is presenting to players and DMs? And do you think it is an accurate one?
If you like take it and analyze it from a how much do people earn, what's the buying power of the average person in the D&D world, it doesn't make a ton of sense, but that's not like unique to 5th edition.
There's
other editions of D&D in which, if you tease everything out, you're like, wait, a farmer, given what they say they earn, can't actually buy the things that they need for their existence. And I kind of think that's maybe why they moved to lifestyle expenses. It's just like an abstract package as opposed to, like, buying everything individually. And, honestly, how much of your D&D world needs to function as an economic system, right? Like, if you're playing a high fantasy, high action kind of game, then you can hand wave a lot of it and just, like, abstract the fluctuations of an economy out to, just an event that happens or a modifier. So if you take a place like Forgotten Realms,
okay,
and you look at all the cities that are up and down the Sword Coast, and you sort of like read into them, look at Sword Coast Adventures guys. They describe basically the same place, each of these cities, Neverwinter, Baldur's Gate, Waterdeep. They're all like mercantile republics where the aristocracy are just wealthy people who buy empty titles, fancy themselves as these warrior aristocrats as if they were from Cormyr or Tethyr or something like that. You just kind of get the sense that this place, that these worlds that D&D describes, the implied setting that's in the player's handbook, looks a lot like more, say, the 18th century than medieval times, because it's a cash economy. People are carrying around physical coins that they are buying and selling things with. It's not barter, right? Like most medieval economies run on barter and trade and things like, or, like trading for like services, not coinage. All kinds of institutions that are in these things, I think they're there because, like, they're created by modern people who have a modern understanding of things, and it's, like, very difficult to switch your mindset to even, like, a couple of centuries ago, let alone, like, 1,000 years ago. It's a weird mix of different time periods and influences and the like, and it's not meant to be a functioning economy, and there's a lot of modern conceits that are put on it. And so what you get, and for dungeon masters who want to like analyze these things and create an internally consistent world, they get frustrated by this patchwork and abstraction and mix of influences on the setting. And they go looking for like, I want my game worlds to look like the historical periods that this game is supposed to be based on. And then, they realize, like, well, this isn't a medieval society at all. It's barely like fantasy medieval, but it has this patina of medievalism that, to me at least, makes everything very, like, incongruent and just sort of like, this is weird. This episode is for those of you who like that medieval setting and want to, like, transform your worlds into something that resemble it as opposed to, like, letting the rules dictate what kind of world you have. So a fine distinction, but I think it's an important one.
Yeah, because kind of see it as like what, say, Game of Thrones presents. But that's, of course, a medieval society that's been there for like 6,000 years.
Right.
But they use gold. There's people that provide services, and everybody uses gold for transactions.
Sure. It's not that there wasn't gold or coinage in medieval times. It's that it wasn't as widespread and circulated.
So, and like centralized.
Or centralized, for that matter. And banking was something that was really only like accessible by the highest levels of a society. Monarchs, the heads of state, potentates, things like that. Your average person, and again, because this is, talking about medieval history, there are always exceptions. Depending on what time period you're talking about, things could be different. I mean, it's like a 1,000-year period of history from, say, 500 to 1500. In one tiny corner of the world, it's hard to make universal statements about it. In general, most people don't use coins. Most people don't have access to that kind of thing. Even if they live in a big city and have, say, access to money lenders or something like that, coins are not standardized necessarily, and they might be different from city to city and country to country, and you know, there's no such thing as standard weights and measures yet. So a lot of it is based on like how much do you trust the person that mm-hmm. you're doing business with to yeah. not try to cheat you with TIN money.
Yeah, those measurements that are like, oh, it's the weight of the king's hand.
Yeah,
yeah. The length like from that. His elbow to his
finger. Yeah, basically. Right. I think about this a lot because I think about world building and I'm a, you know, big fan of history and studying history, and I can see a lot of DMs out there who seem to be like frustrated that the world of D&D and particularly like the economy of it doesn't work the way they think it should.
Okay, so you kind of you've explained a couple of things about an actual medieval economy, but if you wanted to take that template of a general medieval economy and lay it on your D&D world, what would that look like?
I mean, it looks very different, and as we said, it's difficult to like transport yourself to that time and place because their worldview, their outlook on life was just so completely different. Like the impact of, say, the Enlightenment on how we conceive of human nature, individual autonomy, the legitimacy of government, all of these things changed for those people living in you know, countries that have an Enlightenment tradition. And it's hard to see past that to a world where the family that you were born into determines most everything about you, where social mobility is really non-existent. Your life is governed by forces beyond your control, and you just sort of like deal with it.
Yeah.
Where there's no clocks, right? Like, just think about that for a minute. Like, you don't have a clock. You don't have to like be somewhere at a certain time every day.
There's no specific, I'll meet you at 2. There's... Right. I'll meet you in the afternoon.
Yes.
I'll meet you at sunset tomorrow. Sure. Yeah. You know, it's just the generalities.
Just the generality. Or it's like tied to, say, church bells. You know, I'll meet you around, you know, 5 bells. It's a different world. And I think it's one of those things where if you're a dungeon master, and this is another one of those things where I really just see like dungeon masters asking about this. I really see like players going like, man, my character's life isn't bad enough. I wish it was more medieval. It's something worth considering, something to think about. It like, is this just something that you want to do for your table, or is this something that would enhance your game? I think it could be really enlightening and sort of enriching and create a setting or world that's really multi-layered and complex, but it's not for everybody. I guess to kind of like break it down and just go into the nitty gritty of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's get into the mud and the blood.
Oh my God. For a medieval economy and the society that produces it.
The biggest thing to think about and the biggest thing to keep in mind during all this are two concepts.
One of those concepts is called the estates. And our own history is there consists of three groups of people: those who fight, those who pray, and those who toil. And basically the knights and aristocracy, the priesthood, and literally everyone else. So you take a country like France in the Middle Ages, that might describe like 97% of the population or the third estate. That includes, you know, the wealthy lawyers and bureaucrats who work king's court, as well as the dirt farmers out in the countryside. And then roughly a half, you know, a percent and a half for aristocracy and clergy. And you might be able to like translate those to say like aristocracy and the wizardry or aristocracy and something else. Keeping that in mind is important because it means that like the vast majority of the people are engaged in food production. Really all they do is provide food for themselves. And if there's a little left over, they go to a market once every couple of weeks, sell it there, or trade, or more likely trade it for something else. The medieval economy is based around mostly what's called a manor. And so it's a lord or a feudal lord or something, or a representative of a feudal lord. Mm-hmm. And they've got a mill where you grind your grain. They've got all the sort of like things that you would need a wine press to make wine with, or other sorts of like what we would consider like capital investments that they provide. And then in order to get access to those, the villagers sort of give a portion of their labor to the lord, and they work the lord's fields for a while and give the surplus from that to the lord or the church or whoever it is in the form of taxation. And then whatever they get for themselves on a tiny plot of land, they can keep for themselves. And you think about like that's the world where like 97% of the people, that's what they do. And then like how in the world does anybody become an adventurer? Mm-hmm. You know, how in the world do you have the extra calories to become an adventurer and not like, when am I going to learn how to do this thing? I barely have enough food to eat for myself, let alone like go down a goblin hole and fight them.
Well, now I'm just seeing like a dragon sword that's nothing but like bales of wheat, bags of grain, and barley, and it's like, tame, it's not gold, it's just, it's food.
It's a different place. For one, if you're playing in this kind of world, you can't just like show up to a random village in the countryside
and be like, I'm gonna pay for this long sword that I bought in this village of 50 people with actual gold money. It's like, number one, there's probably not a sword there.
There's probably no one there that knows how to make a sword. The blacksmith there maybe shoes a couple of horses, makes nails, makes tools for people to use.
He just learned how to make a hinge and put shutters on all the windows now.
Right. You know, cutlery, plates, that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
They're not making, like, military-grade weapons because that's the providence of the monarch. Medieval society is obsessed with laws and obsessed with legitimacy. And it's not this, like, anarchic place that is lawless. It's actually a place where they love laws so much that they have multiple sets of them. Clergy are governed by ecclesiastical law, and the aristocracy is governed by a whole different set of laws. Many of them not even written down. They're just sort of like customary privileges and mm-hmm. obligations. If you're a member of a guild, you have a different set of laws applies to you versus, say, the students at the university in town. You know, you look at a town like Cambridge in medieval times, and the conflict between the students at Cambridge University and the townsfolk in the town of Cambridge is constant. They hate each other because the students can come through town and just do whatever they want, and they're never going to get in trouble for it because they are governed by a separate law. That's another concept that it's hard for us to think about. Like, we really pride ourselves as, like, the rule of law, and we are all governed by the same, and no one is above it. There's, like, literally in the medieval society, it's the opposite. There are beings and things which are above the law. Same applies for the king, right? If there's a monarch or something, they almost always are bound by customary, obligations, traditions, rules. Sometimes that represents in, like, a parliament-type body that advises the king. But in places like Spain and France, their parliaments were... they kind of atrophied, as opposed to other places like, say, England or even Poland, where their noble bodies, persisted and lasted. Number one, it's all over the place, and you really can't say one thing about medieval society without being able to point to an exception, which is what makes it such a rich and wonderful time period to, like, draw from, because you can find so many things to inspire you. But it is a very, very different place. That blacksmith that you're trying to buy something from, even if they have a weapon for you, like, why would they take money? They can't eat it. The farmers that they get their food from aren't going to take that money. They can't buy anything with it. It's worthless to them.
Yeah, they probably don't go 2 miles outside their village.
If that's the case, and this is sort of the life that you have in the villages, like, what does life look like in the towns? Well, first off, there's not that many of them, and they're really small. Like, they're not these teeming metropoli with millions of people in them. They're maybe a couple of thousand in a tiny walled enclosure. They guard their privileges there very jealously. They sometimes will have, like, say, a charter from the monarch that allows them to be exempt from certain taxes or obligations in exchange for other taxes and obligations. So, like, don't call us up with your banners whenever you fight, don't make us do any of that, but we'll give you a cut of our profits from, say, the wool trade or something. Or it might even be that, because they rely on their existence, by permission of the king, that the king's just like, yeah, I take whatever I want from you, or you have to give me, like, the first tenth of something like that. Town life is gross. It's unsanitary. It's crowded. There are fires all over the place. It smells. Mm-hmm. It's, entirely dependent on the countryside around it, providing food and raw materials. But it's also a place of freedom. A lot of times there'd be like some sort of law or custom where if a serf managed to live for a year and a day inside the walls of a city, they were considered a citizen of that city. And that represents one of the limited forms of social mobility you might have. City life is often governed by guilds, which is like a Venn diagram of guilds would be like productive labor, religious obligation, and civic function. And so okay. You'll have, like, say, the Cobbler's Guild, who sponsors several churches in town and shrines or whatever, and then on religious holidays participates in a parade for that. But if the city's under attack, the Cobbler's Guild also supplies a levy of pikemen to defend the walls or something. It's a civil, religious, and economic organization that just, like, dominates and is almost a parasite on medieval life. You can't practice a trade if you don't belong to a guild. And if you try, they'll kick you out. They'll send some people to come rough you up. They're almost like a organized crime in that sense.
Hmm.
Running protection rackets and extortion. And they're the only thing that kind of resembles regulation, but it's always regulation for someone's personal benefit. It's not like right. regulation for the public's benefit. It's like, no, this benefits the guild masters, not anybody else. It is a world in which you are embedded in social obligations and a web of of who's your lord, who are the people that you have a responsibility towards. If you're, say, a journeyman guildsman, and you've finished your apprenticeship in one town, you go over to the next one to seek employment, no one's going to listen to you unless you have multiple letters of recommendation from masters who can vouch for you. One of the things about the medieval mindset is just like the utter distrust of human beings.
People come over the hill. Are they here to raid us? Are they here to to reave? To just visit?
Yeah, to just do it. There's fear of strangers, foreigners, and the like. It is very pervasive, particularly like you're saying, you know, those villagers don't ever leave their village. Then someone from a couple of towns over is a foreigner. Very may well speak an entirely different language or dialect, at least. You're getting like all of these messages about how wretched common people are. They cannot govern themselves. They cannot fend for themselves. They even need to be like, you know, have their spirituality taken care of for themselves in a language that they can't even understand, because like they don't even need to understand it. So there's like this deep disregard for humanity that's pervasive throughout the Middle Era or Middle Ages. But there's also a greater sense of obligation to your community, and a lot about medieval life is that mutual obligation. In theory, a knight is there to both serve their lord and protect their peasants. The fact that that was so often not the case, you know, I think just says something about how difficult it is to establish civil society that can provide a sense of peace and stability for people. They were also battered by all sides from all different, you know, invasions, calamities, famine, disease. It's a fascinating time period, but it is very different than the typical D&D world. I think that's something to consider if you're like, my world's not medieval enough. I'm like, do you want it medieval?
After knowing all that and taking that into account, what do you think a D&D world that is medieval, what does that look like? Everything, I mean, just magic alone, that's not even bringing in just like divine intervention,
sure,
things like that.
I think it's worth sort of like working through the implications of the pervasiveness of magic and things like that. And maybe we'll cover that in another show or something. But to have a more medieval world, you start with whatever the central authority is. One of the things that defines a medieval mindset for me is the idea of an authority figure, a monarch or something that is the source of both like, you know, sort of civic pride, or like, yeah, this is my king or my monarch, but also like in a lot of ways they're the nucleus around which nationalism would eventually form. And the idea that, say, you go from being, for instance, say, king of the French to king of France, mm-hmm. and that transition from I am the monarch of all French people to, well, I am the monarch of where all French people live. I'd start with that. What's the relationship between the monarch and the people? Are they, you know, selected by a council of nobles or a religious mm-hmm. figure, or are they, it's entirely hereditary and sort of like passed along through dynastic lineage? Maybe it's, you know, it's some sort of combination of both. Almost everything in the medieval world is negotiated and is a compromise. We tend to think of monarchs as like absolutists and my word is law, but mm-hmm. that's more of an early modern invention. In the medieval era, it was, I mean, it's about the physical limitations of it, right? Like if you're sitting in your throne room in the capital city, like how are you going to get someone out on the border, you know, like a border earl or something, to do what you want to do when it takes days or weeks to get a message to them? Like, you have to be able to trust your nobles in some part to like do their job, because you can't be everywhere. And it's amazing that they were able to centralize the way they did it all. You've got to have a license to adventure. You have to have some kind of permission from an authority figure. You can't just strike it out on your own.
Yeah, right. Just much like, you know, you can't just go hunting on the king's lands. You can't go hunting for dungeons on the baron's lands.
You certainly cannot. No. And if you find it, that's not your goal. Those are not mm-hmm. your magic items. You did not have permission to go in there.
Yeah. So probably they would find the dungeon. They would have to mark it.
Yeah.
And they have to come back to town, petition for a right to adventure.
Yes, to get a monopoly on the dungeon.
To get a monopoly on the dungeon. And then what? Then you'd have to negotiate, well, anything that comes out of this.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would have to be taxed at X rate.
Yeah, and chances are, if you're doing that, then you are probably also a noble in the court of that monarch. So, like, most adventuring companies probably have a noble in them, and they're probably formed around that noble because they're not going to let non-nobles have weapons or spells. Like, why in the world would you do that? That's just asking to have your social order overthrown.
But again, I think that's why we come back to when you look at like Waterdeep or any of those, you have all these people that aren't really nobles, it's just money.
Right.
And so you have to expand the idea of what a noble is. Right?
You do. You have to. And it's not as if there aren't, you know, just really uber rich people in our own history who pretend for, you know, to sort of like put on aristocratic airs because, you know, they can't.
Right. Back to the conversion though.
Sure.
Instead of trying to rationalize.
So that's sort of where I would start. Mm-hmm. And you might get something, you know, sort of like silly and lighthearted, like an adventurer's guild that sort of like fills this function, or it could just be like a reward for favor at court is that you get to clear out this section of wilderness and whatever ruins and weird things are there, you get to keep, or get to keep a portion of them. Or at least, you know, they're not yours. They're on loan, mm-hmm. you know, on loan in perpetuity or something like that. What's the relationship between rulers and sort of the authority figures in the world and magic users? Mm-hmm. Yeah, is it a case where magic is seen as a weird and bizarre practice where wizards have to give up all kinds of creature comforts and social niceties in order to master their magic? Are they outcasts and weirdos who have sacrificed everything for this power? Or are they, you know, favored at court? Or do they rule at all? In which case, pretty sure we're not talking about a medieval society anymore. We're talking about something else.
Yeah.
But you could have monarchs who are dabblers and the like. You know, dilettantes at magic. You know, they have better things to do than deep dive into the study of magic. But you can't be a noble without knowing something about magic.
And you have to know a trick or two just to entertain the peasants.
Just to entertain. Yeah. Exactly. You know. So everybody, you know, they know a little bit, a little like reading of the mind or protecting themselves from evil influence.
Every noble just gets magic initiates. Up.
Sure, yeah. Why wouldn't you, right? Like, in the medieval era, there was a concept that developed and grew and grew and grew until eventually it reached its culmination in the early modern era, but it was known as the Grand Tour. And it was the idea that if you were an aristocrat or a noble or you know, of royal blood, that you would, at a certain age, just, like, go around to other courts in the world and, like, learn horse riding, learn how to fight, learn how to dance and sing and all this other stuff.
Oh yeah, especially you go to this place because they have the best horsemen. You go to this place because they have the best bows and archers.
Yes.
And
and you learn a little bit of it. You could apply that to D&D as well, as where all your nobles do have a bit of everything. If the magic's in the world, then they might know. At the very least, they might be proficient in Arcana. Mm-hmm. They can recognize the difference between a sorcerer and a wizard.
You would want that. Otherwise, in this world, I mean, these nobles that have this power, they have it because they have money and they have lineage and everything, but they'd want to have people pulling one over on them.
Right.
Because one of these peasant sorcerers pretend one day.
Yes.
But, oh, wait, you didn't go to that university.
No.
I don't see any spell components in that spell you just cast.
Yeah, exactly.
Seize him,
right. Yeah. And sort of like imposters and people who pretend to be figures of authority and try to like pull one over. There's all kinds of stuff like that in you know, medieval history of like, I'm the long lost brother of the monarch, or I'm actually the last of this line of kings. And you know, like, yeah, never mind that you thought I wasn't, you know, that we were all gone, but I'm not.
Yeah, you can trace your lineage back beyond Charlemagne.
Right, and so there very well may be spells that deal with that. That, you know, custom magic that verifies your lineage or that proves you are who you are or something like that. Let's see what else you could do with the medieval society. It's one in which you want to have characters who are embedded in their social relations. Who they know will determine a lot about how they move about the world. Mm-hmm. Or you could flip that script and go like, maybe adventurers are the dregs of society. They are social outcasts. They are people who could not make it anywhere else. They have no one to vouch for them, mm-hmm. no one to recommend them for employment anywhere, no one to help them out. And the king occasionally just comes through and is just like, all right, who are all the weirdos, traveling people, you know, just the people that are not part of society. And maybe they are the adventurers because they are the ones that they don't have a stake in mm-hmm. this community.
Yeah.
If they disappear, nobody's going to miss them.
Yeah.
Right.
Because they're one of them rangers.
One of them rangers, something like that. Yeah. Or if they do something they're not supposed to, you don't have to worry about treating them however you want.
Right.
You know, you can't just treat a noble however you want. They have certain privileges. In some cases, that even applies to like serfs and peasants. Like there were laws and traditions that were like, hey, you can't do this to people. Mm-hmm. Like you have an obligation to protect them.
Maybe that doesn't apply to adventurers, you know?
Well, yeah, because they're not citizens of this city.
Right.
You know, they just showed up.
Yeah.
They don't have a job. They go out in the wilderness. They've been raving up and down, like stealing from whatever, because that's all that they can do. You piss off the wrong person.
Yeah.
What do you do?
Yeah.
What recourse do you have?
Yeah, you don't, no laws protect you. You're literally an outlaw, right? Yeah. Like you do not benefit from laws. And maybe that's like the point of it, right? Like maybe you choose that life. Maybe it's a societal status that you can voluntarily enter in a sense of like, yeah, I am choosing right now to take on this life. I voluntarily remove myself from the protection of the laws and obligations of society in order to have this freedom. But I'm going to miss having a place in that society. And so it's like, yeah, you might have wealth, you might have influence with some sort of like, you know, monarchs or wizards or whoever, but you will always be on the outside of that. You'll never have a place in that world, even if you have a use for that world. And so maybe that's part of the tension of that. It starts off as a game of, you know, dungeon delving and, you know, traditional D&D style play, and then becomes maybe about overturning that social order or something like that. Is that a world you want to play in? It's very different than a D&D world.
Yeah.
It's very different than the kind of like standard play experience. It requires the characters to like understand some a bit about how the world works and the social relations of it to really get invested in it. Otherwise, like, I would just play with the standard rules and accept the fact that this is a weird, like, it looks more like the American frontier as settlers pushed westward.
Oh, totally.
They just have swords instead of rifles.
So rifles and pistols, totally. Yeah. Yeah.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more.
Want to see us play? We've got games every week on Twitch, which we upload to our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays.
If you like the video, hit that subscribe button, click the bell, give us a thumbs up, and tell us in the comments.
Thanks for watching.
There's a bunch of nobles here who engage in trade. I'm just I'll wait for this to pass. You heard a guitar too, didn't you?
I thought guitar guy was gone.